Good morning, everyone. And after that very happy picture of what Common Venture has been, I am so delighted to follow that and to be with all of you. And another thing that truly delights me as we celebrate these 50 years of Common Venture is that we can do it while Sister Marie Therese is still living and breathing and walking among us, while we can still see her physical presence and remember the large spirit with which she began this program. So, and to have the opportunity to continue to recognize and to thank her. And I also want to express gratitude to the planning committee for this event, and especially to Shell, who has put a lot of work into this and who still continues to be the motor behind Common Venture, largely behind the scenes. So thank you, Shell. So I'm very happy to celebrate these 50 years, stepping back into this experience, walking around and what that was like and what it meant for us individually and for all of us as a community, and to look forward together to whatever comes next. I especially liked this theme, Seeds of Service, Harvest of Justice. And so I'm happy to reflect on that theme with you this morning. I think, first of all, that seed is such a wonderful image for this celebration of 50 years, because a seed somehow mysteriously carries within the pattern of its own unfolding future. And yet, the way it turns out depends so much on all that surrounds it and nourishes it and keeps it going. That's what we celebrate in this gathering. Next. So our revisiting the experience of service is an opportunity and to look back and to see what has sprung up, to see what remains, what has faded, what has deepened, and what we would like to take up again and carry forward with the perspective of all that we have lived and learned together in these 50 years. Next. The Common Venture dream from the beginning was to plant seeds of service. And as Peggy O'Neill just expressed in her video, if you found your way to Common Venture, that seed of service had probably already been growing in you. Next. Something in you had been ripening that found some resonance when you first heard about this service opportunity. Not everyone was drawn to Common Venture, but you were. So the seed was already in you. In fact, somehow you were the seed, and you still are the seed. Next. So you set out on this Common Venture journey, which clearly was an act of faith. It was a risk. It was an adventure. Next. An Irish saying, your feet will take you to where your heart is. And so you set out on the Common Venture journey without knowing where you were going, but probably found something there that your heart recognized as somehow familiar. It was a moment of unique openness and readiness, a moment of self-discovery. John Donahue says, every time you leave home, another road takes you into a world you were never in. You find yourself in a different way, more attentive to the self you bring along, your more subtle eye watching you. A new silence grows within you, and if you listen, you will hear what your heart would love to say. A journey can become a sacred thing. Travel in an awakened way, gathered wisely into your inner ground, so as not to waste the invitations which wait along the way to transform you. Next. Now, clearly, in Common Venture, lots of seeds got scattered. Next. Seeds of service and seeds of people like each one of us. Now, I think that that scattering is very significant. We heard the many places in the opening prayer that Common Venture was scattered towards. Nature does that. That's how plants give life and produce fruit. So as we celebrate today, think of the fruit that was produced in you when you were first scattered into a world of people and places and probably difficult situations unfamiliar to you. And for the congregation, we have never been the same since Common Venture, that Common Venture scattering that took us out of Dubuque and exposed us to cultures and needs we probably never knew. So many new ministries were born of that. And I think the community has been transformed because we were all scattered by Common Venture. So today we really celebrate that. What transformation happens personally when we get scattered to unknown places? We're vulnerable in new situations. We step out of business as usual and no longer find ourselves on automatic pilot. So it's a privileged moment that allows us to discover ourselves and a whole new world with fresh eyes. I always remember when Nancy Meyerhofer and I first went to Chile in 1980, and Nancy shared with me her first letter home. Nancy, I don't know if you remember this, but it's always stayed with me, excuse me, because what you said so interpreted my experience then and in other subsequent moments. She said, "I keep bumping into the best of myself and the worst of myself." The best. Oh, I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I had that in me. And the worst. Oh, I really didn't know what to do in that situation. I didn't handle that well. So both of those aspects are unique opportunities for us to discover ourselves. And probably much more important than discovering ourselves, we have discovered people and the world around us in new ways. If we are open, there are always surprises because life just doesn't conform to our expectations and stereotypes. So think for a moment of what you discovered in meeting people who were Native Americans, veterans, people with disabilities, children in need of tutoring, African Americans, prisoners, immigrants, and so on. The scattering is a place of encounter with real people and with real needs. And as one of the volunteers said, we meet them in the flesh with names and faces. So African Americans in general are now people you might have come to know in Mississippi or Chicago or Waterloo. It's Miss Lizzie in the used clothes store looking for something for her grandchildren, or Sasha on the playground who always seems to be fighting with someone and then goes home to an empty house till her mother gets off work hours later. In the real world of a culture different from our own, we are given the gift of discovering from the inside the beauty and the richness of customs and symbols not usually visible to outsiders, such as the giveaway tradition at some Native American funerals. Now, the good thing is when we step into the world of real people, we are in danger of having our perspectives changed and our stereotypes transformed, and our judgments challenged. Again, a personal example of that. When Nancy and I began in Chile, at the time of the dictatorship, we began by visiting houses. We just went around and knocked on doors to get to know people. And in one house, a young woman invited us to come to a family party that night. And she said, my uncle will bring us home. We thought, oh, this is a great opportunity. We'll see how people in Chile celebrate their parties. So we went. And at the party, we started to notice that the uncle who was supposed to bring us home was drinking pretty heavily. So we talked to each other and decided we should ask him to take us home early while he could still pretty safely drive. And on the way home, he wanted to stop and walk on the beach. He was the driver. There wasn't a lot we could do. Anyway, so here I am walking along the beach in the dark with this man who had been drinking. And all of a sudden, he started to weep. And he said, I have tortured so many people in my life. And I just remember at that moment in the dark, my eyes flew open like that. And I thought, oh my goodness, I'm walking in the dark on the beach with a drunk torturer. This can't be good. But at that moment, he started to pour out his heart. And he talked about the memories that flooded him and how he could no longer live with himself because of what he had done. And that's why he took to drinking. So what I learned that very early time in Chile was that perpetrators are not monsters. They are mostly hurting people who then hurt other people and are affected by what they've done. And they themselves also in need of healing. So the way our stereotypes, judgments, and perspectives are challenged is one of the great advantages of an experience like Common Venture. So returning to the theme, seeds of service, harvests of justice, I have to say when Shell first sent me that theme, I was intrigued with the question of, well, how do you get from service to justice? So does service automatically produce justice? I wasn't sure. And as I sat with that question, what came to my mind was the title of a book by Beatrice Bruteau. Next. And next. Beatrice Bruteau wrote a book called The Holy Thursday Revolution. So I'd like to just reflect on that a little bit. And what I'm going to say really is not the content of her book, because I read the book a long time ago and couldn't even find it again to use as a reference. But my reflections are kind of on the title of that book, which seems significant to me. The basic idea of her book is that the elements of service in Jesus washing his followers' feet at the Last Supper really provide a blueprint for a more just society. And that gospel account is a beautiful teaching of service and self-giving. So I want to continue reflecting on the question, how to understand service as the way to a revolution. Can service lead to an upending of an unjust and unequal world order? Can it somehow bring about a different way of relating, a different social structure, a different human dynamic? Now, I don't think that happens automatically with Common Venture. Service experiences can be a sort of volunteer tourism. Or they can be what sets us on the path of a deepening commitment to a life of service. I do think that a person who lives into Jesus' pattern of authentic service is gradually transformed and then becomes that presence that transforms the surrounding world into a more just and loving environment. However, I think that needs our awareness of the values embedded in service and a conscious intention to live them in our personal, communal, and public lives. So let's consider together the elements of service that Jesus taught at the Last Supper. Next. And next. John 13, they were at supper and Jesus got up from the table, removed his outer garments, and taking a towel, wrapped it around his waist. He then poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel he was wearing. Next. Do you understand, he said, what I have done to you? You call me master and Lord, and rightly so I am. If I then, the Lord and master, have washed your feet, you should wash each other's feet. I have given you an example so that you may copy what I have done to you. Now we know that Jesus at this moment in the washing of the feet in the Last Supper is really anticipating his passion and death. And he's constructing meaning. He's teaching values, the values that matter most to him that he wants to leave as a legacy. So front and center here is the Paschal mystery, the core of our faith, and Jesus' humble love, Jesus' wisdom for the world, the legacy he wants to leave, teaching us to do as he did, to lay down our lives, to spend our lives, our energies, in responding to the needs of others. In our lives are not our own. For whom, for what, is the health and the energy and the resources that we have received as a gift? Learning the emptying, the kenosis of Jesus, the needs of others placed before our own, pouring ourselves out as Jesus poured out his life in service, emptying ourselves so that others can be filled, and knowing in the example of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus that death is a genuine path to life if it is simply the cost involved in real service, the path of prophets and martyrs. Not always easy, certainly with struggles, and in some of the common venture groups, there was little sense of success at the moment. So Jesus' example of the service of humble love really is a challenge to society's race to something bigger and better. And Jesus demonstrates that small is beautiful. When we look at society looking after profit at all costs, and Jesus simply sharing and in presence, we see the world promoting personal comfort and ease, me first, individualism, and Jesus models the service of the common good. If the world were to operate in the spirit of Jesus' service of humble love, a more gentle and a more just human dynamic would reign on earth. A true revolution. Next. Service is personal. It is really seeing the other and really being seen. It is genuine encounter. And when Jesus at the Last Supper kneels before each of his disciples, one by one, looks them each in the eye, enters into their physical space, touches their feet, connecting, touching, literally. It's very personal. Now, you did that on Common Venture. If you think of a person you met, a world that you touched, a connection that changed you, just be with that question for a minute to allow some memories to come to mind. the personal aspect of service is a challenge to society that often makes individuals or groups of people invisible, just cogs in a wheel. We live in a capitalistic economic world order that renders a lot of people invisible and disposable, whose needs and rights are less important than the product that comes to us and at the price that we demand. The clothes we wear represent the invisibility of people in sweatshops with low wages, with no right to organize. The fruits on our table, put there with little recognition of the immigrants picking the grapes or digging the sweet potatoes. But if you were on a common venture team serving the migrant farm workers picking sugar beets in southern Minnesota, suddenly those people are no longer in the shadows, and their needs and struggles and insecurities are present when you pour sugar into the cookies that you're baking. So when Jesus really sees and touches each of his followers personally, that is a revolutionary gesture for a society in which those who are poor and marginalized just are not seen. Black lives do matter. All lives, all persons matter. But first, we really need to see each other. Now, as you know, Pope Francis talks frequently in this vein about the culture of encounter, which is, I think, his desire for both the church and the world. But he also said at the second world meeting of popular movements in Bolivia in 2015, the following: "We do not love concepts or ideas, we love people. When we look into the eyes of the suffering, when we see the faces of the endangered campesino, the poor laborer, the downtrodden native, the homeless family, the persecuted migrant, the unemployed young person, the exploited child, the mother who lost her child in a shootout because the barrio was occupied by drug dealers, the father who lost his daughter to enslavement, when we think of all those names and faces, our hearts break because of so much sorrow and pain. It moves us. It makes us attentive to others in an effort to move forward together. From those seeds of hope, patiently sown in the forgotten fringes of our planet, from those seedlings of a tenderness which struggles to grow amid the shadows of exclusion, great trees will spring up, great groves of hope to give oxygen to our world." End quote. So that kind of personal encounter that Pope Francis speaks of is the spirit of Jesus, and it is the spirit of Common Venture. It is to really see people and respond to their very real needs. It reminds me of Sister Kenneth personally encountering the children with multiple disabilities at Hills and Dales in Dubuque. And it reminds me of my own first Common Venture experience visiting people with quadriplegic disabilities in the long-term care facility of Cook County Hospital. I had never before met a person in that condition. They were invisible to me. So Jesus' way of service invites us to see real, concrete human need. And in doing so, it connects us at the fundamental level of our shared humanity. I don't think it needs to be said that the people we serve are not perfect by any means. And it doesn't take long for any Common Venture team or any real life situation to quell the romanticism with which we might have begun. Jesus teaches service without judgment. He washed the feet of Judas Iscariot. Jesus' style of service is gratuitous. It's not earned by good behavior or by having acceptable viewpoints. There is indeed a revolution in that. As Margaret Wheatley has said, it's not our differences that divide us, it's rather our judgment of one another. Next. Another element of service. At the Last Supper, Jesus taught us the value of service, but he also gathered with his friends to share a meal in community. That table event reflects and makes present every other table gathering during Jesus' lifetime. The backdrop of this Last Supper is Jesus' consistent modeling of inclusive community. No one was to be excluded from his table, not tax collectors and sinners, not women, not foreigners, not Gentiles, not the ritually impure. All were to be welcomed as friends and equals. And again, in the backdrop that's present, Jesus' parable of the heavenly banquet. A servant is ordered to go out into the city streets and bring in the poor and the blind and the lame, anyone. Now, such radically egalitarian table sharing flies in the face of all the social conventions of any stratified society. Walter Brueggemann poses this situation. Think for a moment. If beggars came to your door, of the difference between giving them some food to go, or inviting them into your kitchen for a meal, or bringing them into the dining room to eat in the evening with your family, or of having them come back on Saturday night for a supper with a group of your friends. Some of those options would be unthinkable. Table fellowship is a map of economic discrimination, of social hierarchy, and of political differentiation. Jesus' life and teaching, seen in the community of disciples gathered at a last meal, calls us personally and collectively to a non-discriminating table that reflects a non-discriminating social order. The revolution of Holy Thursday invites the whole world to just an inclusive community around one table in radical equality. Next. Jesus called them aside and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their superiors exercise authority over them. It shall not be this way among you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant." Next. This is Jesus' teaching about power, about importance, about authority. All human relationships involve power dynamics of one kind or another, but here Jesus redefines them. Power is simply the capacity to serve. The person with the greatest importance is the one who serves the community. Servant leadership, rather than domination and coercion, is the revolution our world desperately needs to establish right relationships of respect and of justice. I won't spend time here reflecting on the social, political, and economic transformation that could happen if our world leaders lived Jesus' spirit of service. It's so obvious. What would happen simply if our lawmakers spent their energy in service of the common good rather than in getting elected and staying in power? However, I do think it's worth thinking a little bit more about the element of mutuality in power dynamics and relationships. Next. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "At the moment, you do not know what I'm doing, but later you will understand." "Never," Peter said, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus replied, If I do not wash you, you can have nothing in common with me. Now, once again, Peter didn't get it. He was unwilling to receive from Jesus, who was demonstrating a loving relationship among equals. Service is mutual. And if it is genuine, we know that we always receive as much or more than we give. And hasn't that consistently been our experience in Common Venture? However, that takes a certain kind of humility. Peter initially was not showing that. So here, I would like to just invite us to revisit an article often used in Common Venture's orientation entitled Serving is Different from Helping and Fixing by Rachel Naomi Raymond. This article suggests very eloquently that in helping and fixing, we approach people from a position of our own power and expertise. And that sets up a dynamic of inequality. To quote very briefly, helping others incurs debt. When you help someone, they owe you one. But serving, like healing, is mutual. There is no debt. I am as served as the person I am serving. When I help, I have a feeling of satisfaction. When I serve, I have a feeling of gratitude. Next. Gratitude. Thanksgiving. Eucharist. Breaking and sharing bread and sharing lives among equals. That gesture is inseparable from washing feet. Both are transformative for our world. Both are a revolution. Next. We are personally refreshed and made new in the process, even as our service falls like the dew on those we come to serve. The seeds of service do indeed produce a harvest of justice, one person, one transformed life at a time. And the fruit that we can expect is joy. Next. It is a harvest of happiness. Next. Next. The joy of service is a deep interior joy where darkness and pain can also have a place. That kind of joy springs from an inner sense of rightness, and that is the joy that we bring to this celebration. Next. We don't know what the future of Common Venture might look like, but we celebrate with deep gratitude all of the fruits in the lives of volunteers and of people served. It is so beyond what any of us could have imagined. Next. Whatever the future, it will be a hand outstretched in service, living the spirit of Jesus' teaching at the Last Supper, stretching towards the fruits of justice. I would like to end these brief reflections with a song that is at least 50 years old. So you will hear that the words and some of the concepts probably aren't what we would use today, but the sentiments are certainly our prayer today as we give thanks for these 50 years of blessing.
Scatter the good seed on the the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, and soft, refreshing rain. All the gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, thank the Lord for all his love. All his love.